You're in a good place now. Relax, breathe, smile. You've entered into your element, the home of origin, the home of intelligence and entertainment, where relevant topics are discussed and where what you think counts, and where superior is the norm. You're listening to Perspectives with Ashley Burgess, live on 660 The Answer.
Happiness is when you really feel good about somebody. There's nothing wrong being in love with someone, yeah. Oh, baby, love and happiness.
Love and happiness.
Love and happiness.
Welcome back live to Perspectives, and I'm your host, Ashley Burgess. And on tonight's show, we're exploring what it means to be happy. You know, I realize to some, this question may seem simplistic, what it means to be happy. It seems to most that happiness is one of the most elusive things out there. You know, I think happiness, if sold on the black market, would be actually very expensive. I think it would be the most highly paid, most sought after item out there. Think about it. A G5, nothing compares, though, to genuine happiness. No matter the item or monetary value, if you could honestly trade happiness for it, I think people would be lining up around the city block, around the country. It'd be like that ending of Field of Dreams where everybody drives over to the baseball stadium to see it, and you see the line of cars and the lights that go all the way around the United States. It's quite interesting. It's one of my favorite movies. But I think happiness is a big deal, and I think a lot of people feel like they can never be happy. Bill, how are you doing?
I am feeling happy tonight because I'm here on the radio with you.
Aww. I love that, Bill.
About that raise we're talking about? No.
I knew that was coming. I could feel it. I could feel it. Eric, how are you doing?
Hey, I am very happy to be here. That's my quote from Coming to America, right?
I love that movie.
Yeah, very happy to be
now
here.
Now smile real big.
Yes, look at me. I'm very happy to be here.
I love that one. I like when they're trying to sell all the hair products and the combs and the gold-covered hair dryer.
Glow.
Get these crazy hair products. They're covered in 24-karat gold. That's the man that stole our bags. And he runs away.
Happy, happy. Let the happy train move on down the road.
So we're talking about happiness tonight. What does it mean to be happy? And, you know, I figured out what happiness means. I figured out what it means to be happy. And happy is what? Honest, authentic, present, purpose, and young at heart.
Whoa.
Wow.
That's profound. Say that again.
Yeah, please.
Say it again.
Please.
Happy is honest, authentic, present, purpose, and young, in parentheses, at heart.
I like it.
Does she have a phone number?
Yes, she does.
For a good time, call
1-888-HAPPY. So we're talking about happy tonight, and I think in order to honestly and truly be happy, you have to be on point with all these five accounts. And we begin our perspectives conversation with H, that stands for honest. Honesty, honest with yourself is what I think we start with, is being honest with yourself. I think being honest with yourself about where you are and what you're doing is pinnacle to be happy.
Well, you cannot be honest with anybody else or anything else unless you're honest with yourself first. It starts with the self.
Anything healthy starts with honesty.
Yep.
What do you think? Anything that's healthy starts with honesty.
And you got to be honest with yourself.
I think so.
Which is, and you well know this, Ashley, easier said than done. I mean, it's hard sometimes to be honest with yourself.
Well, yeah, sometimes it's easier to not see the truth.
Or deny the truth.
Or yeah. Deny the truth.
Denial is not a river in Egypt.
He loved that one. No, it's true, though. Think about that. Think about being honest with yourself. Think about being honest, though, in your dealings, in your personal dealings with people. I mean, how honest are we when we deal with other people, when we go into business with other people, when we have relationships with other people?
You know, I've been fortunate to be in business and do a variety of things in corporate American consulting. And the older I get, the more I realize, Ashley, that, you know, when I was younger, you would try to adjust to the situation. You would try to say things that you thought the other person wanted to hear. But as I've gotten older and matured and won some battles and lost some battles, I realize my authentic happiness, my desire, that emotion is an advantage. And that's something that's rare in the world today. Sincere happiness. I mean, just look around while you guys are driving around tonight as you go about your daily course of life. How many people do you see that you can generally say they're happy? Think about that.
I mean, true happiness, not happiness you can buy. A lot of people make the mistake of trying to buy happiness.
Buy happiness?
Not only from other people, but for themselves.
Yeah, or co-opt happiness.
Yeah.
You know, be a part of someone else's happiness and co-opt it for their own self. I travel a lot, and sometimes I just watch people in the airport. I watch their motions. I watch how they walk. I watch a lot of different things, and the vast majority of the people don't display that real, authentic emotion of just being happy.
I agree with that. I look at it on a daily basis. You see people that you walk around. You see people in business settings. You see people in their cars driving from point A to point B. And it is interesting how, honestly, most people aren't happy. And a lot of people think they can buy happiness. And that goes back a lot of times to parental upbringing. Mm-hmm. When a parent brought children up with the fact of, I show love based on what I buy you. So if I buy you this or I buy you that or I buy you jewelry or I buy you a car, that means I love you. And I think people demonstrate they feel love that way. So therefore, later on in life, they demonstrate love that direction. And I think that's one side of where people get the whole buy concept of happiness.
Oh, I see it all the time. Parents trying to buy their kids happiness. You know, they want to be their kid's friend rather than their parent. You know, my girlfriend and I had this discussion once upon a time, with her niece and nephew. I mean, she spoils the bejesus out of those kids. and those kids know if they want something, they just go ask Aunt Jen, you know? And it's like sometimes, you know, the best thing to do is tell them no. You know, you can't have that. I mean, now, if you want to work and earn some money and go get it, that's fine. But, they're going through things and I want to make them happy. Well, I mean, are you really making them truly happy by just buying them stuff? Because then what's going to happen when they grow up and be adults and all of a sudden the bank of Aunt Jen has closed?
Well, you also train people that way. So you're training a child to be that way. I see it all the time in the stores when you're going from aisle to aisle, especially like Target, the grocery stores, those kind of places where there's candy or toys or anything that's available, and you see kids actually having a breakdown.
Oh, yes.
And the screaming and the yelling and that, Mom, I hate you, and the, you know, and all this stuff's going on. Mom's over there like, oh, gosh, you're not, you know, you can't have that, you know, and all of a sudden they give in because guess what? They've always given in. You know, it's like training a dog. It's almost like training an animal. You know, when you get a dog, you get a puppy, and you bring him into the house, if you don't sit there and try to feed them, like, food off the table, they're never going to know that what the food off the table's like.
Right.
But right when you start doing that, they're like, man, that's so much better than kibble. I mean, what have I been doing this whole time?
Yeah, no joke, huh?
I mean, I need to be up here at the table with the people. I don't need to be down there by the bowl. And so then you retrain them, and the next thing you know, guess what? You got what you got.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, that you know, that's kind of interesting. That's a good point, Bill, in regards to the kids and all of that. And you're right. I think we have a responsibility, and we do start them off early with using things to elicit a particular emotion, obviously in this case, happiness. But, you know, I think we're all a product of that. What we see on TV, when you see the brand new car, you see people smiling. When you see the new home, you see people smiling. When you see the ladies walking in the store with the new Donna Karen bag, you see people smiling. And so we consciously and subconsciously equate happiness with things. Is that necessarily a bad thing, though?
Material things.
Yeah.
And yet on the other side of the coin, how long has humanity been searching for, you know, answers to, like, you know, what is true happiness, you know, from a soul perspective.
And we get farther and farther away from it with every red bow that we see on a Lexus commercial around the holiday season. I mean, you know, they're good looking cars, don't get me wrong. But at the same token, you know, is that really love? But let's go back to the concept of honesty. Honesty in our dealings, honesty in our relationships. And I think that's crucial. How honest are we with the people that we know? How honest are we with our family, with our friends, with our spouses, with our boyfriends, with our girlfriends, with who? How honest are we in our situation with them?
Well, from my perspective, I mean, I try to be as honest as possible. And because, for one thing, I don't have a good memory. There's kind of an old saying, if you tell the truth all the time, you don't have to have a good memory. Okay.
Well,
I subscribe to that.
Yeah,
I mean, tell people, Bill, I say I'm not smart enough to be dishonest.
That's right. Yeah, and neither am I. Yeah. You know, so it's always better to tell the truth. However, I will say, and maybe we can get into this more, a little bit later, but there is such thing as tact, and so it's not that I'm dishonest, but maybe the way I word it, or sometimes I'll choose not to
selective.
You know, yeah. I mean, because I don't want to hurt somebody's feelings, depending on the circumstance.
But also, let's flip the coin. Not about just factual evidence of I went here, I did this, I did that. I can't tell a lie because I won't remember what I said the next day. What about the flip side? How honest are you with your emotions with those people that you have relationship with? Let's get a little deeper.
Okay.
Let's not skim the surface here. Let's get a little deeper.
Dig in.
How intimate and dig how honest in. About our intimacy with these people are we?
Ooh, that's deep for guys.
Yes.
Deep for guys.
It's an issue with me that I'm working on because I'm not good at expressing my emotions and I'm not good at explaining them either.
Well, there you go. We have a lot to talk about tonight.
Yeah, we got a lot.
I know. I think I need to lie down on the couch here.
Yeah, yeah.
The couch is in the other room, apparently, but we can all move the studio in there. But no, we're going to talk more when we return about honesty, about dealing with your past, about dealing with your emotions, about being honest with the people around you. Later on, we'll be talking about authentic. So stay tuned, because Guess What Perspectives is digging in and exploring exactly what it means to be truly happy. Perspectives with your host, me, Ashley Burgess, will be back in. We'll be back in two shakes.
I'm learning to fly. Turn it up and jump in the deep end on Perspectives with Ashley Burgess. The water's warm and there's a swim-up bar. Glass of perspective, anyone? Now, here's Ashley.
Welcome back live to Perspectives, and I'm your host, Ashley Burgess. And on tonight's show, we're discussing and exploring what it means to be truly happy. You know, some of y'all might think this is a simplistic question, but I think most people listening tonight would really like to know what happiness truly is. What does it mean to be happy? And right before the break, we began discussing happiness and happy, and we talked about how happy is honest, authentic, present, purpose, and young at heart. So let's talk and continue our conversation on what it means to be honest. You know, we were talking earlier about being honest in our dealings, being honest in our relationships, and, you know, being truly honest. Like Bill brought up the fact, like, you know, hey, I don't tell a lot of lies because, you know, I don't remember what I said.
Yeah.
And, you know, Eric was saying he's not smart enough to lie that much. And so I'm talking about, let's get past the I was here and I did this and I did that and I got home at this time. Let's talk about being honest with our emotions, honest with the people around us, and honest with intimacy. I think when we deal with our emotions, we're honest with that. It takes our relationships to a different level.
Well, and that's kind of a struggle for me because I think I'm naturally inclined. I'm an introvert. Which is the source of our tension, every now and then, because you're very much an extrovert, and
I could be an introvert in some sort of sheep's clothing.
Could be, because Di was saying before the show, we're both Geminis,
both Geminis.
It's like
we should have already killed each other years ago.
I was going to say that's what she was saying too. But
yeah, somebody save the Pisces from this show, please. please.
You are hooked. Yeah. But
oh man, I never heard that one before.
but yeah, I mean, so just my natural inclination is to not show my emotions, because I feel vulnerable when I do, and it's something I've been working on to do, and. But still, I mean, I struggle to not only express the correct emotion, but also to maybe to explain it.
Yeah. You know, that's funny, Bill, you say that because, my thing has been I've always, to a certain degree, and I'm a lot older now, but I was always embarrassed or ashamed that I was emotional as a male because my mother had a big influence on my life. And so, from a conditioning standpoint, I was always very emotional, which has helped me in my creative life. But I've kind of been the other way. But as a general rule, men aren't conditioned to show emotion, and therefore we lack sometimes the tools to be able to articulate how we really feel.
Because it's a muscle.
Exactly.
It's a muscle.
Because we don't exercise.
You got to work it out.
And
yeah.
So when we do fall in love, or we do find someone that we really care about, or we do have a situation that really touches us in some kind of profound way, it's hard for us to find the words to express it.
Yeah.
And that's a challenge for, I think, the male species in general, to be quite honest.
Well, I don't think it's only male, though. I think we should go a step further. I think strong women. I think everybody that's listening right now that's a strong woman that has had to maybe bring themselves up, that raised themselves the parents weren't home a lot, you know, and they were maybe a lot of only children out there, a lot of the eldest children out there that, you know, basically raise the other children. I think that it's hard to get to your emotional core because you're so much trying to run things. You're trying to be at the top of your game work-wise. You're trying to be at the top of your game, get your house, take care of your bills, pay your bills, and always ahead of that, but you don't really have enough time to really grow your emotional level. And I think that's an issue lately, especially in society today.
Yeah, and who made that rule? I mean, who made the rule that emotions, an outward display of emotion, is somehow a deficit? Who made that rule?
Because I think it's a cultural thing.
Yeah, I mean, that's my point. Yeah. But who says that that's right? Because most of the people that I've been around that are profoundly human, profoundly spiritual, profoundly just being, are people who have a healthy balance of emotion or a healthy display of emotion in their life. They're more vibrant. They're like the flowers in the rainforest. They've got the color. They've got the scent. They've got all these things working, which allows for a more vibrant experience. And so I think longer term, as we continue to evolve, the expression of emotion is a good thing. Am I wrong?
Well, I mean, I think it depends on the situation. See, here,
authentic emotion.
Here's, you know, the culture and, you know, kind of background where I come from. You had to be careful about being too emotional because I think Ashley hit the point, you know, if people are depending on you, you know, for their living or
leadership
or for leadership in the family or whatever, you can't afford to, I'll put it how my grandmother used to put it, you can't afford to waste time.
Yeah,
you know, with
that's
all that
point.
Stuff.
That's a good point.
You know, you've got to get up and go to work. You've got to get food on the table. You've got to, you know, get clothes on kids' back. So you don't, you can't sit there and how she put it, waste time.
Did my grandfather raise? Was he in your family?
He may have been. I don't know. But I think that's where it came from culturally.
Yeah.
If
you're right.
If people depended upon you, then you have that, to, you know, being strong equals not being emotional.
That rural agrarian culture where you're, you know, out farming in a rural area, you got to, you know, do the things to feed your family every day, and there's no room for emotion in that. So, yeah, no, I get it. I get it. Yeah. But as we evolve, as we become more of a civilized society, I think it's something, and life is fluid, I think. And I think it's something that we can look at again in regards to where emotions fit in our life, authentic emotion.
Well, I agree with what you're talking about. And I think a lot of times why society deems showing emotion is not a good thing is because we as a society, we as a race of people always outlaw what we don't understand.
Yeah.
Okay, it's better to say that's illegal and that's not right and that's not proper and you can't do that and you look like a sissy when you do that. There's something wrong with you when you do that. This is outlawed. It's banned. It's banned from your behavior when people don't understand it. I mean, it's a lot easier to hide something. It's a lot easier to put somebody away. I mean, think about our society as a whole as far as even the elderly. I mean, there's other societies. There's other countries in this world that actually care about the elderly. They care about the aging group of people in their life. And we, not across the board. I'm not saying everybody listening tonight. I mean, there are situations where it's so difficult you can't take care and you do need assistance. But for the most part, we are a disposable society. And how can we do that if we really truly have true emotions with the people around us? You can't just throw them away.
Yeah, no, I agree. And you know, and I always say this whenever I'm on, that's what I love about this show, having an opportunity to talk about these issues, to bring these issues to light, have honest discussions about these issues. There's no right or wrong. I think it's just a pursuit of a higher level of understanding. And that's what I love about these types of discussions. We're talking about happiness, authentic happiness. And that's a good thing that we're talking about it as opposed to suppressing it.
Yeah.
I agree with that. And I think so as we're talking about being honest with our emotions, we're talking about being honest in our relationships. I think sometimes, too, if we look at it, I think sometimes maybe we have a tendency of maybe not being honest, you know, with our heart. We like to analyze things. I think also we have a tendency of glamorizing things or romancing things in the past that didn't really work well instead of being honest about what really happened. And so we look back at the past with great nostalgia and we miss it, you know. And it's like in reality, when we were back in that and that was the present time, it wasn't that good.
Well, memory is selective. You tend to be selective about the things that you remember, not only on an individual level, but on a, you know, cultural level.
Yeah, it's funny, Ash. I was just talking to my sister, Eric, and you met Eric, and we were just talking about that, how we both came up in the same home, same experiences, but we see those experiences completely different, not negative or more positive or whatever, but it's just different based on those perspectives. But I want to go back to your point, Ashley, about happiness and honesty and authenticity and all of that. The thing that has caused me to accelerate my pursuit for authenticity and honesty and happiness has been being a father. Because when I look at my kids, I look at the fact that I have a responsibility to be a positive impact on the lives of three human beings who were sent to me as a gift. And I realize that in order for me to be the best dad that I can be, I have to give it to them in the most authentic, real, loving way possible. So they can have the ability to discern as they get older. And I have to do that. And that's really accelerated my growth.
Because, Eric, if you don't, your kids will see through it.
If I don't, they'll see right through it.
Kids are so smart. They pick up on things. They may not necessarily understand what they're picking up on, but they intuitively pick up on things like that.
Well, children are closer to the source, so that makes sense. And also, they don't have a lot of mask. You know, they don't have a lot of mask. They don't have a lot of baggage, and they haven't been... their emotions haven't been exploited usually. If they're in a good relationship with their family, usually they're allowed to exhibit emotion without having stress from what's going to happen or try to hide it or try to mask it or try to change it because it might not be what people want to hear. And so I think as we grow and as we go through life, depending on the relationships that we have, depending on the quality of relationships we have, that's why there's a lot of people that are in their 20s, that are in their 30s, that can't be honest with their emotions because they're scared to be. What happens if they're honest and somebody just blows them out of the water for it? I mean, it hurts. And I think when people get burned a lot, they tend to run away from intimacy and they tend to not be honest and they tend to do whatever they think is going to happen to win the game. And so it becomes like a game. And so the honesty is no longer a part of it. So when we return, we're going to continue talking about honesty, about being authentic as well. We're figuring out what it means to truly be happy here on Perspectives with Ashley Burgess. And we'll be back in two shakes.
This is Jake Busey. And you're listening to Perspectives with Ashley Burgess on 660 The Answer.
Gary Potter, great to have you on the tour, Happy. I feel a lot of solid energy coming out of you. Good, positive aura. Great, great. It's all great.
Yeah, nice to meet you, man. Is it always like this with the TV cameras and the people and stuff?
Oh, yeah, a lot of pressure. You got to rise above it. Mm-hmm. You got to harness in the good energy, block out the bad. Harness, energy, block, bad. Oh. Feel the flow, Happy. Feel it. It's circular. It's like a carousel. You pay the quarter, you get on the horse. It goes up and down and around. Circular, circle, with the music, the flow, all good things.
Yeah, all right. Well, great. Thanks a lot. Nice to meet you, man. Cycle.
Welcome back live to Perspectives, and I'm your host, Ashley Burgess. And on tonight's show, we're discussing what does it mean to truly be happy. What does it mean to be happy in life? And I think we've discussed what happy is, right? It's honest, authentic, present, purpose, and young at heart. You know, I think all those things together, when we actually do these things, when we're on point with these things, when we follow suit with these things, what? We become happy. We're happy people. So right before break, we've been discussing being honest with our emotions, with ourselves, with other people. And I think intimacy is such a big deal. It's such a big conversation because it's something that a lot of us have a difficult time dealing with. I know that it hasn't been easy for me. I'm not one of those people that just overly emotional. I'm not one of those people that just cries at the drop of a hat. I think most people try to hold that emotion in because of the feeling of not wanting to be seen as weak, not wanting to be seen as somebody that cries at the drop of a hat, not wanting to seem emotional, quite honest. I mean, think about how many times you hear somebody saying, she got really emotional. You know, it freaked me out. And I think that's key.
Well, and also, too, I mean, put it in the context of what you're talking about. A lot of times when we say, oh, that person's emotional, it means what we associate as negative emotions.
They're problematic.
You know, and
they
anger
need help.
And, you know, crying and whatever. And if you let go of those too easily, then, yeah, I mean, you're seen as weak. So our culture, puts a premium on, you know, keeping that stuff in and rewards people for doing that.
Yeah, no, I, the great artists are very good at selectively allowing emotion to exist, I would imagine. So,
but
right?
that's a disciplined, in other words, they can do it or don't, and in whatever dose that they choose.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's why it's admired.
Yeah, no, I agree. But, you know, I go back to Ashley's point earlier, you know, being authentic, regardless of what it is, regardless of where you are on the spectrum, I think it is very important. And I, too, sometimes have a very difficult time with certain levels of intimacy and emotion and all of that. But I think after you get to a certain age, certain age for men, certain age for women, you know, hey, you just kind of let it go, you know, let it go and live and let live and be free, because ultimately you're living for that happiness. You're living for that inner peace. You're living for that inner joy. And things external, I think, become less important as you get older, hopefully.
I agree with that. I think eventually you get to that point where you realize, you know, you're not going to be here forever.
Yeah.
And you just have to let it go, you know. And so if people are going to accept it, they're going to accept it. They don't. And I think at that point in time, it's almost like a selection process in its own. I mean, you can select and deselect by people accepting or not accepting you, quite honestly.
Yeah, I had a young lady at church, and she's an elder, but I call her a young lady. And there's a group of elder women at church who are mostly widows, and it's a group of sisters, and they're all widowed.
My grandma used to call them widders.
Yeah, widders. And they're the happiest group in the church. And one day, this was maybe a couple of years ago, I pulled one of the sisters to the side. I was like, you guys are the happiest people in church. And she said, baby, I've had a husband. I've raised my kids. My husband is gone to be with the Lord, and I'm going to live this life, and I'm going to be happy, and nobody's going to tell me what defines my happiness.
Amen.
You know? I mean, Amen. Seriously. And they're the happiest bunch in the whole church, man.
And you would think, and most people would think the opposite.
You would think the opposite.
Oh, well, they've lost their husbands. Their kids aren't there with them. You know, they've moved on, what have you. And they're, like, pretty happy.
Yeah, man. And they're just a joy to be around, because why? They accept the realities of their circumstances, and they're living for themselves because they've lived for others their entire life. And I respect that greatly.
Yeah, they're not defining their happiness by material things.
By material things or external things, to some degree.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think that's hard too, what you just brought up, the whole thing about putting your happiness on external things or financial things, because a lot of times people do that, and guess what happens? You know, something happens financially, and their happiness is equal distance with whatever happened.
I mean, some of the unhappiest people I know are what we would consider successful people.
Yeah.
You know, financially, materially, externally well off, okay? But they're miserable.
I've been there, Ashley, and you bring up an excellent point. I was talking to my wife about this actually about a week ago. I was in West Virginia and calling her, just telling her how much I miss her, and I was reflecting on when I was in my 20s, I was that person. My happiness was contingent on how well I did on a business deal, how much money I made. And when I lost everything, I found myself depressed, not because of anything inner with me, but because I had lost money or a deal didn't come through. And I said, you know what? I don't want to live on that yo-yo. I don't want these things to control me that are completely out of my control. It's not a good way to live.
You know, and actually, real quickly, from a religious standpoint, especially the Western religions like Christianity have always put a premium on spiritual happiness rather than material happiness. And, even in the Bible, that's why Paul always preached about, look, you can either do one or two things. You can either give yourself to the Lord, or you can give yourself
to the world. Yeah.
Either way, you're giving yourself to something. But if you give yourself to the world, then it's a never-ending cycle. You've got to have more and more and more and more, and it just never satisfies you.
And Bill, that's a good point. That's where that word joy comes into it, that elevated happiness that's more inward versus external. And I think that's how they define it. Joy is a spiritual experience versus happiness, which is more externally driven. But very good point. Very good point.
Well, yeah, and I agree with that. I think also, thinking about a lot of times people, like you talk about money, like you talk about success. And I know people in my own life that literally look at a certain level and they go, once I get there, I'll be happy.
Yeah.
And then they get there, and then they go, well, once I get there, I'm gonna be happy. And then they get there, and then they're like, yeah, you know, really, once I get here. And so it's a competition, and I've caught myself there myself.
We all have.
Oh, yeah, I go in and out of that sometimes, you know, where you go there and you go, I gotta, you know, harness and figure out what's going on here. Why is my drive going that direction when I should be happy to some degree where I am right now? Because this is never going to be happening again. These experiences in my life will never happen again. I'll never be able to relive this again. And I think sometimes we forget the fact that we get so into our routine and so used to the people that we see and the things that we do and this and that, that we start forgetting that this isn't ever going to happen again. This exact circumstance, this exact day, this exact minute, this exact experience, we take for granted will never happen again.
This exact show.
This exact show will never happen again.
You bring up
although real quickly, Eric. You know, it may never happen again live,
but
a person can always.
That was awesome.
That was sweet, baby.
How's this for a segue, You know, fist bump. Yeah.
That was sweet as candy.
You can always go to iTunes. You can go to AshleyBurgess.com, or you can now go to
Spreaker.
Spreaker.
In the house.
Just like Speaker, except with an R.
You can actually, I found on Spreaker, you can actually put Ashley in. That's it. And you just put Ashley in, you push enter. And you'll find me. It'll show Ashley, it'll say Perspectives with Ashley Burgess on there. It's amazing. Just Ashley works on that one. And then on iTunes, you can put in Ashley Burgess or Perspectives with Ashley Burgess. Mostly Ashley Burgess works as well.
And so this show will live forever because you can go back to it and listen to it as many times as you want. You know,
and share it with other folks that you think might actually benefit from listening to the show.
And when you're driving to work.
That's so spreaky.
You should listen to this show every day when you're driving to work. Just bring it up on Spreaker on your smartphone and put it through your stereo. And it just puts you in the right frame of mind.
And if you're on Facebook, because I know a lot of people listening are, you know, you're on Facebook either because you love Facebook, you're on there for your work, or you're on there to watch what your kids are doing. Or you're there to watch what your grandkids are doing. Whatever you are doing on there, all you have to do is you can actually access Spreaker from Facebook directly. You don't have to do an extra who and hat and do all this stuff and add any extra passcodes, and you can actually go direct.
That's right.
So that's kind of cool.
You know, sometimes on our shows, we kind of, you know, talk bad about our culture and some of the faults of our culture, and it's got some really positive points. And the one thing I love about our culture is that we have the ability to create something that did not exist before. Spreaker. Come on, man. Spreaker.
So Ashley.
Speaker with an R.
Next time we're talking about my raise, just remember I gave you the plug.
But Ashley, back.
Hazard pay. Ashley's about to get some hazard pay today.
But back to a point earlier. You talked about happiness and once you get to a certain point, you know, there's another point, this and that. And quick story, I grew up on a different part of the tracks and here in Dallas. And one of the things I remember growing up back in a couple decades ago was there was a lot of suicides in the wealthy parts of town. And we couldn't figure out why, because from the outside looking in, from the outside looking over, you know, you got the great cars, you got the big house, your parents have the careers, you've got the notoriety, you've got the polos that you're wearing every day. Why are people killing themselves? Are they killing themselves?
I mean, like I said earlier, material wealth doesn't necessarily mean happiness.
You got it.
You're right on that. You are right on that. So when we return, we're going to be discussing the A and happy, which is authentic, as well as starting to discuss as well as the P, the first P in happy, which is present. So stay tuned because Perspectives with your host, me, Ashley Burgess, will be back this time and this time tonight live in Two Shakes.
I can lift you up. I can show you what you want to see and take you where you want to be.
Get in here. Give us your perspective. We're listening. And you're listening to Perspectives with Ashley Burgess.
Welcome back live to Perspectives, and I'm your host, Ashley Burgess. And on tonight's show, we've been exploring what? We've been exploring happy. What does it mean to be truly happy?
Happy, happy, joy, joy. Happy, happy, joy, joy.
Let's all hold hands and say we're happy. Yay! I like your song there, Bill. That was nice.
It was Ren and Stimpy back in the day.
Ooh, I remember the show!
Stimpy, you idiot.
Stimpy.
That's why my mind is all twisted today.
Thank you for Ren and Stimpy. Yes, I like that. That is why your mind is all twisted. We're gonna just blame it on that show. Okay, so Happy. Let's talk about this. We talked about honest. Happy, remember, happy is what? Honest, authentic, present purpose, young, at heart.
And real quickly, Ashley, for those of our listeners following us live tonight, please go on Facebook and Twitter and share your stories of being happy.
And how you feel
you
can be happier, or how you feel that you've experienced happiness, or what you're doing now to actually stay in the moment and be happy.
And Bill, you bring up a good point. Listeners, please do that, because what we found in recent pop culture history is that happiness is what? Contagious. Mm-hmm. Contagious. So we encourage folks to get out and do that.
Yeah, it's contagious. That's a good contagious thing. This isn't a bad thing. This isn't a disease. This is something that you want. So let's talk about authentic. Being authentic. What is it? Being authentic, your own authentic self. Having an authentic life. Making authentic choices. What does that mean? That means making choices, understanding yourself, being real, being true to yourself, right? Not trying to be anyone else. And I think that being authentic in your life is so important to be happy, because when you're trailing after other people, you're trying to be like other people, you're trying to mimic a life like other people, you want to have all this stuff going on. And I know a lot of people that are younger watch a lot of TV shows and they want to map out that life. They want to have a life like that, but that's not going to offer happiness.
When you look at commodities today, we're talking about authentic. When you look at art, when you look at the finest wines, when you look at the finest cars, when you look at the finest...
Finest women.
When you look at the finest jewels...
You know where my mind is tonight.
When you look at the finest jewels of the world, what's the word that typically precedes those things? It's authentic. And so if those things have the highest value in human life, then why not human authenticity? Think about that. If authentic art can fetch $50 million for an authentic Mona Lisa, why not apply the same philosophy to your own human self? Be the most authentic person you could be. Thus, you're extremely valuable by nature,
well,
by design.
You know, Eric, I mean, when Ashley was explaining the concept of the show tonight before the program started, and, you know, A is for authentic, I'm sitting here going, how's she going to make a segment out of this? Because I think it's one of those things that, okay, duh. You know, authentic makes you happy. It almost needs no explanation, because I think it's just a condition of the human psyche, your subconscious. If you're not being authentic, you know, it's kind of like what Abe Lincoln used to say. You can fool some of the people all the time, all the people some of the time, you may be able to fool yourself some of the time, but if you're not being authentic, if you're not being real to yourself, your subconscious knows it. And it will express itself in, you know, certain ways.
But it's rare today. I mean, I think it really is rare today. I think it's rare.
Especially in today's tabloid, where our culture for some reason puts a premium on, going overboard, extreme with a lot of things.
I think it's rare. Now, maybe some of our listeners out there driving and listening in your homes and listening parties, maybe you have the benefit of having authentic relationships to those who are close to you. But when you look at our society through the lens of media and leadership and all of that, I just get the sense, and even art, even what we consider pop art today, I just get the sense that authenticity is something that needs to be discussed, that needs to be analyzed, and something that's rare.
Kim Kardashian. Excuse me.
Always blaming the Kardashians.
Oh, I cannot stand that.
But they are an implication of what we're talking about. You know, it is all about being authentic. I mean, and I know that to you, Bill, it sounds easy breezy, like I'm always authentic. But I think for most people, they've been bred to not be. I mean, you know, think about back on the playground when you were a kid and maybe like you fell and you cried and then you figured out after being totally taunted and made fun of that you're not going to ever do that again, right? But think about like even looking and think about even dealing with reactions from people, like trying to draw a specific reaction from someone because you want to be liked. You want everybody to like you. So you feel that being authentic, you might not be liked. Maybe people won't get you. Maybe they won't understand you. Maybe they won't like you. Maybe they'll think you're an idiot, a nerd, a jerk. You know what I mean? And I think that's a big deal. And I think a lot of times people feel naked when they're authentic.
Well, and, you know, a perfect example is that, when I came into the studio tonight, I was talking to you about, of course, we had the big elections this past week.
Yeah.
And I'm a news junkie. And I was telling you, you know, I mean, I was up till 2 a.m, you know, following, and you just looked at me like, oh my God, you're such a nerd, which I am. I mean, I admit I'm a
and that's okay.
Nerd on that kind of
stuff. That's okay.
You know, general society, you know, if it's like, you follow the news, really? I mean, you know, I want to watch TMZ, you know, what's the latest Kim Kardashian did?
I want to be lied to.
You know, yeah, exactly. So, you know,
watch the news some more.
But, you know, the more reactions I get by, you know, you actually watch the news, then the more I'm like, well, you know, I'm just not going to,
maybe,
you know,
I shouldn't do that anymore, because nobody likes me if I do that.
Yeah, exactly. You know, I mean, I think it's human nature to want to be part of the cool crowd, you know, and it takes a lot of courage, I think, to be authentic.
It does, and therein lies, again, the rarity of it, that fine diamond that you find in the mines of South Africa, or that fine piece of art that you find in the halls of Europe. It's rare, and therein lies, and it's authentic, and therein lies the value. And the same applies to us as human beings, I think.
I agree with what y'all are saying. I think we need to take it a step further, too, because I think being authentic is not just being yourself and being honest with yourself and with everybody around you. Because once you are being honest with yourself and you are being authentic, it shows to everybody else. But I think that you have to dig it. You have to like it.
Like,
you have to like
yourself.
You have to accept it. And you have to like yourself. You got to love yourself. And you got to love the authentic self, not be like, man, oh, geez, you know, I got to be this person, you know. But I think you got to be able to embrace it. I think you have to be proud. I think you have to be authentic and proud.
There's two people that I've been in my conscious recently that display that. One, as you guys know, I love jazz. Miles Davis was that kind of guy, because people played a certain level of jazz during his time. And Miles said, you know what, I'm going to play the way the music sounds in my head, regardless of people like it or not.
And at first, people criticized him. Bebop at first. He's credited with, you know, sort of inventing bebop.
Yep.
But at first, it was not well-liked at all.
Yeah, and he said he tried to play the other music, but it wasn't authentic to him. And when he found that space, that's when his music blossomed, because he was true to himself. And the other was Muhammad Ali. It's the 40th anniversary of the Thriller, not the Thriller in Manila, but the Rumble in the Jungle. In the Jungle. And Muhammad was the same kind of guy. He had to be true to himself.
And think about, you know, this, and of course, you know, 1960s America,
yeah,
you know, the state of
a lot,
you know,
of stuff
where African Americans were at the time.
Yeah.
And for him to say, you know what, I'm not clay, I'm not dirt.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Muhammad Ali is who I am.
Yeah.
And oh,
whether you agreed with the politics of it or not. But he had to be authentic to himself.
And it took a lot of courage, and he went to jail.
And he went to jail, a lot of things. But anyway, so just a couple of examples that come to my mind, and there's countless others. But I think ultimately you're rewarded. For all you guys out there listening, you're rewarded at some point in your life for being authentically yourself. And that reward may be something that only you know, but I think it's worth it. I think it's worth it.
I agree with that wholeheartedly, and I think that sometimes, like we were talking about earlier, you know, outlawing emotions that people don't accept, you know, it's easier to kind of like sweep it on the rug and say that you shouldn't be emotional, because a lot of people can't be emotional. And I think the same lies with the concept of being authentic. I think some people get scared of people that are truly authentic. I think that some people that are being not authentic, when they come into contact with an authentic person, not only get mean, but they also either make comments about that authentic person because it scares them, they scare them, or they don't want anything to do around them. It's almost like Kryptonite and Spider-Man. I mean, not Spider-Man, Superman, you know?
Superman, yeah.
It's like the Raid and Spider-Man.
The Raid.
You know, I mean, so it's the same thing.
Yeah, but by the way, for our listeners who didn't catch that, Ashley hates spiders.
I don't hate them. They're all I don't hate anything.
You do, because you...
No, scared is the right word. Scared. Yeah.
You
scared.
Murder them.
But scared. I don't murder them. Not all.
You see one,
not
you
the little black ones. Not the little tiny ones. Just the ones that look like either they look like a brown recluse, a black widow, or that wolf spider. Those are the three
which
scare
you
me.
Are all of them.
No, they are
they
not.
They are two.
I let the little
are
black
two.
Ones and the little brown ones go.
I've never seen you let
no,
a spider live.
I let them go. Yes, I do not hurt them.
I have never let you seen you selective. Let a spider live.
I did it yesterday when one was on my back, and I just like pushed it off.
I want to see this.
Selective fear.
It is.
Selective fear. Yes. And you know what? And I feel bad anytime I do have to take out a sputter. I do feel bad. I actually say like a little prayer. I feel bad. I go, I'm so sorry. I am just so scared of
that you just murdered.
They have all those eyes.
Ashley and her aboriginal sensibilities.
I know,
that's so special.
Isn't it? I feel bad about it. I sit there and then I'll say a little prayer. I'll feel bad. And then I'll take its little carcass out there and put it like in, you know, in the dirt.
Bury it. Have a religious ceremony.
Not
over
a burial.
It,
just, I'm not throwing it in the trash can.
Hey, but at least you're authentic.
So stay tuned. When we return, we're going to be talking about being in the present moment, what present means to being happy. Perspectives with your host, me, Ashley Burgess, will be back. We'll be back in two shakes.
You're in a good place now. Relax. Breathe. Smile. You've entered into your element, the home of origin, the home of intelligence and entertainment, where relevant topics are discussed and where what you think counts and where superior is the norm. You're listening to Perspectives with Ashley Burgess live on 660 The Answer.
I like Perspectives with Ashley Burgess, but I prohibit my workers from listening to it.
Welcome back live to Perspectives, and I'm your host, Ashley Burgess. And on tonight's show, we've been discussing what does it mean to be happy? And, you know, before the break, we've been talking about being honest, being authentic, you know, because that's what makes up happy, as well as being present, purpose, and young at heart. So now it's our time to move into present. We're discussing present. The present moment is that thing that's happening right now. You know, it's the happening. You know, we live in the absolute moment. We derive bliss and strength, and we eliminate negativity and self-questioning when we live in the moment. You know, the absolute moment, the present, is all-encompassing. You know, we're everything in every moment, and you're the only person who can take that away from yourself, you know, the whole idea of being present. So I feel that being present in the moment and being present with yourself is one of the biggest things that you need to do in order to be happy.
Yeah, because and it's so easy to live either in the past or to live for what you're wanting in the future instead of, you know, you got to get your Yoda voice here, Ashley, you know.
What's my name again?
Yeah. Whoever the heck you are sitting over there. You got to do your Yoda voice. You know, it's like, this one, a long time have I watched. Never his mind on where he was.
Well, it's true because present is not the past, is not the future. And I think I get what you're saying because it is kind of a deep thought because a lot of us are trained to be thinking about the things that we screwed up in the past or the things that were great in the past, to live in the past. You know, I have a lot of friends that never left high school football. You know, that's a good thought, you know,
like
where
that.
they constantly made the greatest touchdowns and they fielded the ball and they did all this great stuff. And then, you know, they never played in college. And so when they go back and they think about high school, they were the best years of their life. You know, you look at some people that had like a great job. They lost that job. It was the best job I ever had. You know, you have people that, you know, had a relationship that fell apart. That was the best person that I ever had. It's the love of my life. I'll never experience that again. You know, I'll never experience what love is again because I screwed it up. You know, and I'm never going to get it back again. And I think a lot of times we're never living in the moment. We're constantly living in the past for good, for bad, for indifferent, and judging ourselves a lot of times too. Or living in the future, again, putting judgment calls. And the only time that you can't judge yourself is when you're actually in the present moment, living in it and dealing with it right then.
Yeah, you know, my grandfather, who died about, 4 or 5 years ago, he died unhappy. Because the older he got and the more that dementia, you know, took over, he would live in the past. And he had an unhappy childhood. He grew up in West Texas during the Depression, during the Dust Bowl.
That was tough.
And he knew what it was like to go to bed hungry. You know, he knew what it was like to not have, you know, things that we take for granted, you know, indoor plumbing, air conditioning, you know, stuff like that. And, you know, so he was resentful towards some of his family members who he felt freeloaded, quite frankly.
Yeah.
And the older he got, the more he just like, you know, out of the blue, you know, that so-and-so, you know, we used to feed them and they wouldn't work. And, you know, I had to, you know, pick cotton and, you know, and all this stuff. I mean, he lived on a cotton farm. Which, by the way, if you've never picked cotton, it's, you know.
It's painful, right?
It's painful.
Price.
It is painful. Now, it's not just backbreaking. I mean, it's painful. So,
Because there's like little thorns and stuff all
yeah,
over it, right?
Exactly.
Like, it doesn't want you to take it from the cotton thing, you know?
Yeah,
it's like,
yeah, go figure.
We're going to keep it right here.
Thank God for the cotton gin.
I know. No joke, right? So, I mean,
Eli Whitney invented the cotton gin, by the way.
But they did it by hand, you know, because they were just barely making a living in a very terrible time. And so the older he got, the more he lived
in the past
and tried to relive the past, and he died unhappy.
Yeah, I was looking at some show. I'm a physics geek, and I have geek nerdiness things in me too, Bill. So
you can relate.
I am surrounded by the geekiest people on the planet.
The geeks and the nerds shall rule the world. But I was looking at a show, and they were talking about the only reality is the present. You know, and they were talking about the past and the future and all of that. But they were, you know, they were trying to figure it out and scientifically and mathematically figure it out. But the hypothesis was that the only reality is the present. Think about that. And that's truly the only thing that we can impact. I mean, we can be informed by the past. We can be inspired by the future. But the only thing that we can control or manage or dissect or be a part of is the present, which for me kind of makes it simple, because the past sometimes is painful, it's complicated, and the future sometimes is scary and unknowable, but the present is manageable.
Right.
It's manageable.
You know, think about it this way, Ashley. Tomorrow never comes, so you might as well just live in the present.
Right.
I mean, think about it.
Yeah.
You know, when it's tomorrow,
I know tomorrow
it's today.
Today.
You know?
It's today. Yeah.
Put your tomorrows in a sack, mister.
Right?
I don't know. I know. I agree with what you're saying. I mean, I just think that is all about the present moment, because
yeah.
we also lose our judgment. But you know what also we do is when we are in the present moment, honestly in the present moment, we're not trying to self-sabotage ourselves. Like, where, you know how, you know, when you overanalyze stuff,
yeah.
you sit back
Good
and you get in your mind and you go, I don't know why they did that to me, you know, and then you start turning it around and everything starts changing. And then all of a sudden you got all these enemies, you got to watch your back, and you got all this stuff going on. And when you're in the present moment, you know, you're just living. And I think a lot of times we overanalyze everything because, you know, some people like that drama quotient. Some people are just not
yeah.
surrounded by the right people.
Yeah.
And other times, when you sit there and just mesh on something for a long period of time, you can find problems with anything.
That's, you know, Ash, you bring up a really good point. That's one of the reasons I love sports so much. And I know Bill's shaking his head over there.
Yeah.
Because sport is the one spectator event or activity that we can watch that happens in the moment. Now, you have strategies, you have all of that, but each person reacts differently to how they catch the ball, where they run, how they throw the ball, and it's all in the moment. And that's, I think, one of the beauties of sports, because there's history and all of that, but it happens in that moment.
Absolutely. I mean, it's the great escape from the real world.
Yeah.
And you can watch, you know, these athletes who are, you know, performing in at least if you're watching the stands in a level that you're not capable of. And
but they're in that moment.
But they're in
they're,
the moment.
They're in
yeah.
that moment. Yeah.
You know, the sights, the sounds,
yeah.
and, you know, the smells. I
yep.
mean, it's all just very visceral.
And they bring us into the moment with them. And that's the cool thing about it. So there's something really powerful in being in the present, Ashley, and great point to bring up.
That's a great analogy, actually. And that's a great thought about sports. I didn't really think about that before. You know, I think also a lot of times when you're in the moment, it's a gossip-free zone. You know, because gossip to me, I know a lot of people, and I know a lot of people listening tonight, and I know a lot of women and a lot of men that are listening, and myself included, we've all gossiped before. I mean, it's just the way it is. Sometimes it's hard not to. But I've really worked on that, because I realize when I start, if I start talking about somebody else or talking about what somebody else has done, one, it makes me look bad. But besides that, it does take me out of the moment. All of a sudden, I'm no longer in my own moment. I'm talking about what somebody else is doing.
Yeah.
So not only, I think that's even worse than watching TV. That's worse than watching reality shows.
Yeah.
That's worse than watching, all of a sudden, you're not even in your life anymore. You're talking about what somebody else did and ridiculing them for whatever they did. You know, and it's like you're totally out of the moment, and all of a sudden you're bringing judgment into the situation. You're no longer living your life.
Which, by the way, it is fair to say, I know that it's, you know, women are stereotyped to gossip all the time.
And it's not just women.
It is not just women. But, you know, we men, we gossip just as much.
Yeah, but Yeah. It just feels so icky, though.
Well, maybe, but it feels that icky. We do it.
Yeah. Aaron needs to take a shower.
Yeah, it feels icky, man. That's the one thing I cannot stand is gossip. It just feels so icky.
And me too.
And if you're going to be in a moment, let's construct a positive moment. Let's construct an aspirational moment. Let's construct a healing moment. Let's not construct a moment to tear somebody else down. And I think that's what you were getting at, Ashley.
Yeah, because you can't be in the moment. There is no moment.
Yeah, there is no
that.
Moment.
Because all of a sudden you're now in their life or you're commentating about their life. And it's almost like a commentator on a sports show. I mean, they can commentate all up and down yesterday and today about how somebody caught the pass wrong or how somebody fumbled the ball. But in the end, they're not playing the game.
Not playing the game.
Yeah. Okay, you're not putting yourself out there. It's an easy job to sit there and talk about how bad somebody's playing on the field than it is to be out there playing with all kinds of, problems with back issues, gotten the crap beat out of you the last three games. you were unconscious last game, but you got back in the game. You know, it's like after a while, it's like it's easy to sit there and make judgment calls on the side, but those people aren't really living in the moment either. They're actually living vicariously through the people that are actually playing at the very moment.
And I think being in the moment is fertile to happiness. I think being in the moment is a space to where happiness can flourish, because to your point, you're not focused on the past. Negativity doesn't have a place there, because if it's there, it's not really in the moment. The future hasn't happened yet. And so the moment is a place to where you can cultivate a certain level of happiness. What do you think about that?
I like that. But there's a reason you have moment, the same thing as a momentous occasion is part of the word moment.
Nice.
You can't have a momentous occasion in the past, and you can't have a momentous occasion when you're having a B.I.T. whatever
momentous fest. I like that word, momentous.
Momentous.
Big words coming out of Ashley's mouth.
Well, guess what? We got another momentous moment coming up here on Perspectives, because we're going to be talking more about happy and how to find purpose. So stay tuned, because Perspectives will be back, and your host, me, Ashley Burgess, in
Two Shakes.
Turn it up and jump in the deep end on Perspectives with Ashley Burgess. The water's warm and there's a swim-up bar. Glass of Perspective, anyone? Now, here's Ashley.
Welcome back live to Perspectives, and I'm your host, Ashley Burgess. And on tonight's show, we're discussing what it means to be happy, what it means to be truly happy. And, we've discussed that the H in happy means honest. We've discussed that the A means authentic and stands for authentic. The P, the first P, stands for present. And we just finished talking about being in the present moment, about realizing that, there is no judgment in the present moment. There is no judgment. There is no confrontation, really. There's no gossip. It's a gossip-free zone. It's also not a self-sabotaging area as well. When we're in the present tense and we're not thinking about the past, or we're not discussing or scared or stressed out about the future, we're able to live in the present moment. And being in the present really creates happiness, because all these other issues kind of fall by the wayside. And a lot of times we find it hard to be in the present moment because we've been trained so often to really stay in the past or to really be thinking about what's going to happen in our future.
And, Ashley, I'm loving the comments we're getting from our followers on Facebook and Twitter. So, for you listeners, we want to hear your stories about being in the present and being authentic and being honest.
And happy.
And happy.
Yeah.
Happy! So let's talk about the second P in happy. And I believe that this stands for what? Purpose. Purpose. It stands for purpose. And I think purpose means that you have a purpose that you have to take care of. Your purpose is what? Your true calling, I think. Some people would say it's your solemn, your royal duty. Once you realize your sole purpose, you have a true calling, a mission. I think you have a mission. You have a mission. We're on a mission from God. I think you have a mission. And I think when you figure out your purpose in life, it allows you to have clear, conscious direction. I mean, that is key. And I think when you have clear, conscious direction, you don't get off target. And you're not sitting there thinking about stuff that you don't need to be thinking about.
Eric, I'll just say real quickly for those of our listeners tonight who may be tuning in for the first time to Perspectives with Ashley Burgess, this is one of Ashley's major things about why she does this radio show. She's been doing the show. How long have you been doing it for? 4 years? Almost 4 years now?
Almost.
Yeah. From the very first show, purpose has been your purpose. I mean,
it's been my purpose.
Yeah. I mean, you are all about helping people find their true purpose. You've written books about it. You've done more shows about it than I can count. So you can go on AshleyBurgess.com, iTunes, and Spreaker, and you can find all kinds of shows where you are trying to help people find their true purpose.
Because it's important, Bill. I think the overarching, I mean, if you really want a truly utopian society, have everyone in that society living to the highest degree what they're put here to be and do. And I know that's just kind of out there, but you know, when you look at, you know, Bill, you talk about being a Christian, and I too am of the Christian faith, and it's even in Christianity, all throughout Christianity.
Oh my gosh.
It's all throughout it. You know, understand your purpose, and once you understand and become in alignment with that purpose, there's an ease to your life. You find a peace.
It was really the central focus of Jesus' ministry, wasn't it?
It was the whole central focus of his ministry, and once you understand that, your place in God's creation, then life is just that much more enjoyable, that much more peaceful, more fulfilling, and more joyful. And that's, I think, is one of the reasons, because Ashley's done it. And that's why purpose is so important, because she understands that once you find that, that's when you truly begin to start living.
Yeah. You know, purpose is, like you're saying, kind of the central focus, but it's expanded out. You know, for those of you who are listening, if you're not a Christian, that's fine too. But you look at all the major world's religions, mm-hmm. okay? Purpose is something that just feeds the human soul. Mm-hmm. It's not even something we can actually put our finger on, I don't think, although Lord knows we've tried. But you look at Christianity, you look at Judaism, you look at Islam, mm-hmm. you look at Hinduism, you look mm-hmm. at Taoism, you look at Buddhism. The reason why those are the world's major religions is that they go beyond just, okay, you go to a place of worship and you say mm-hmm. a prayer and you make an offering and the deity will give you something back. It's gives you some sort of purpose mm-hmm. to live your life by beyond just material wealth.
Yep.
And that's why it says something to the human soul.
Yep. That's it. That's it.
I agree. I think it defines us. I think it also, let's get a little deep here. If we're not already deep enough.
I was going to say, that wasn't deep enough. I can try again.
Deeper.
That was deep, but let's even take it a next step, level. I think purpose actually connects us to the next dimension.
Ah.
I think that once we figure out our true purpose, the reason how we are connected to the next dimension is why is because it originally defined. I think a lot of times if we actually go back and realize what purpose came from, and you understand the power within yourself as an individual, as a human being, but as a soul, okay, that if you really understand that you actually originally, before all this was all this happened, you actually defined your own purpose prior to your lifetime, and that you're able to reconnect with your purpose and your origins, you're actually able to reconnect at that point with your original self. So there's a reconnection there. Because I think that if you go back, a lot of people feel like we're powerless, that we're just people here and we just go through life and, things happen to us and we really don't know why. And that's a powerless way of looking at life. I think we can look at it from a different thought process, a different dimensional process, and that is really understanding that we actually defined our own purpose before coming in this lifetime. And once we're able to realize why and what it is, and then go to the next step and figure out why was it that I would choose this for myself, that's when you kind of make the full circle of origin.
Well, and look at it from the other end of that spectrum, Ashley. Think about the most unhappiest people that we know, okay? A lot of the times, I'll even say most of the time, it's people who either don't know their true purpose or for whatever reason can't fulfill their true purpose. I mean, those are really unhappy people, and I know because I was there once upon a time.
Yeah, we've all been there. We've all been there. Not only, Ashley, did we go deeper, we went interstellar.
Right, we did.
No. Deeper than that, interdimensional.
Interdimensional, yeah. We're out there. When you look at everything from a macro and a micro level, when you look at it universally, when you look at it microscopically, every living organism, every entity that exists in creation as we know it has a specific purpose, okay? And most creatures that are created understand and accept that purpose, from the ant to the elephant, to the wind that blows. It is us as human beings who have lost sight of the power of purpose. And therein lies the reason in religion, in literature, in music, in art, in this show, one of the central themes, regardless of the topic, is always purpose. I think that's what it boils down to, purpose.
Well, I agree. It's almost like a moth and a caterpillar to a butterfly kind of thing. You don't see the moth over there going, I'm going to be a cheetah. The cheetahs look like they have a lot of fun. Yeah. I'm going to go over there and fly over there by the cheetahs and see if I can't figure out what the cheetahs got going on, right? It's the same thing as a tree, right? A tree blooms. You know, you have oak trees that, you know, that have certain things that fall off the tree. It doesn't sit there and say, I'm in a bad mood.
Right.
I'm going to stop.
I'm not going to drop this fruit today.
You know, and I don't think I'm going to do it today. You know?
To kind of tie this back to the central theme of our show tonight, you know, think about it, Ashley. People who have purpose are happy. All right. And that purpose could be something that is not what we normally define, quote unquote, as material wealth. I mean, some of the happiest people I know are just getting by, but they have purpose.
But let me add something to that, Bill, real quick. We all have purpose, but people who have found their purpose are happy. I think we all have a purpose, but those
you got to find it.
Exactly.
Or you have to be able to pursue that purpose, because some people are not in a situation where they may not be able to.
Yeah, they're covered up. We've all been there.
Yeah.
We've all been there. But even though we're in a situation that prohibits us from finding that, it still doesn't take away from the fact that it's there. Even in your darkest hours, in Ashley's and mine, I think there's always been a sense, albeit sometimes a small sense, that there's some greater purpose to me being here. And I'm sure a lot of our listeners can relate to that to some degree.
I agree with that wholeheartedly. And I also agree, too, that sometimes you find your purpose. And I understand for anybody out there that have figured out their purpose and they're having difficulties just making it all kind of seamlessly go together. And that's normal. Yeah. That's not like it doesn't come like easy breezy. It really doesn't. And there's times when you feel like giving it all up. You feel like maybe I'm on the wrong track. Maybe I'm doing the wrong thing. Maybe this isn't my purpose. Maybe I just thought that this was. And that's normal, too, to have questions. And I think that that's a very normal feeling. But I do think that once you do find your purpose, it gives you honest structure. It gives you direction. But I also think that, you know, there are places that you might have stress, that you might wonder if you're supposed to be doing what you're doing. But I think it's kind of like not fighting through it, but moving through that feeling, you know, and allowing yourself to know that sometimes you're going to feel this way because you're bombarded also by people and situations in this world that aren't on purpose.
And energy.
And energy, right? And the energy of people that might not be on purpose.
Right.
Or the energy that doesn't necessarily want you to find it, or the energy of people that don't understand.
That's what it's kind of the old saying, you know, negativity is like a vacuum. You know, I mean, that one negative person just sucks the energy out of the room.
It can. And so when we return, we're going to be talking about young at heart, how to be young, how what young means to happy, and how you can be happy all the time. So stay tuned, because Perspectives with your host, me, Ashley Burgess, will be back in two shakes.
This is Jake Busey, and you're listening to Perspectives with Ashley Burgess on 660 The Answer. Because I'm happy. Clap along if you feel like a room without a roof. Because I'm happy. Clap along if you feel
like happiness is the truth. Because I'm happy. Welcome back live to Perspectives, and I'm your host, Ashley Burgess. And on tonight's show, we've been exploring and diving deeply into the concept of what it means to be happy. What does it mean to be happy? How can you be happy in your life? And we've discussed being honest, being authentic, being present, being purposeful, having purpose. And, you know, I think that purpose is so important, because once we do figure out our purpose, no matter the obstacles and the stress, and maybe sometimes the, oh my gosh, I hope I'm doing the right thing. But I think once you're on that purpose mark, you have structure, you have direction, and you also kind of get back to your original self, because you had a hand in the creation of your purpose. I mean, it's not like it was just dulled to you one day, you know, before you came into this world. It was like, you will do this and you will do that. I mean, you co-created a lot of this stuff. So let's get real, people. Let's get real and actually get real about the amount of power we actually have. Because I realize a lot of people listening, and myself included, you know, for years, I thought we were a powerless group of people. I really did think that whatever was going to happen was going to happen. But then I realized that's an interesting way of thinking when there's two sides to that coin, right? When you feel powerless, powerless. Well, things just happen to you, so you just have to kind of go with it. And the other side is you don't really have to do anything. And I think both of those things are really short-sighted for how powerful we are. So let's move into the why for happy. What is that? Young. At heart. You got to be young at heart.
You'll notice a little pause there. Young at heart. Because age is just a number.
Just a number.
Age is just a number. And you can either be, you know, younger than you are, you know, age-wise, or you can choose to be older. And I think I've said on previous shows before, you know, I'll use the example of my dad, who's only 61 years old and in very good health, actually, no major health issues, but he's an old man before his time. And it's kind of sad.
I am growing my beard for No Shave November,
right?
In support of Cancer Awareness Month. And even though there's so much gray on my face right now, I'm 18 at heart, baby. I'm 18 at heart, baby.
The 18-year-old Santa Claus by the end of the month. 18-year-old Santa Claus.
18-year-old Santa Claus, man. No. I talk about him a lot. I mention him in this show, but you know, having kids keeps me young. Not just from a terminology standpoint, but just watching them, just a blissful experience of just being a kid, running, laughing, joking, smiling, being goofy. There's something magical about that, and I take a lot of that for my kids. So young at heart means something, and it keeps my blood pressure at a manageable
level.
There
you go. There you go. So. Yep.
I agree with that. I think also being young, you stop defining yourself by a number age.
Yeah.
And we talked about this on a past show about how a lot of times we define ourselves by labels, by ages, by, oh, well, everybody else my age isn't doing that. Or, you know, everybody else my age is going to the early bird dinner. Or everybody else my age is having iced tea and I can't have a glass of wine because I won't fit in. Or everybody my age isn't going to the theme park or isn't having fun or isn't riding their bike. And
yeah.
It's like, stop being your age. I mean, honestly, stop being your age. I mean, since when did your age become you?
You know, you bring up a good point, an interesting observation. When you've maybe gone to school with someone, a grade school, a high school, and you hadn't seen that person, maybe you've moved away your career, you've had a family, and what have you, and then you 20 years later, 30 years later, 40 years later, when you encounter that person, you're not, it's a disconnect because you're still encountering that same spirit, that same essence from 40 years ago. And so when you look at them physically, it's somewhat of a disconnect because that the essence of that person has not aged. Now they've got experience, they've got, you know, all these other things, but their essence has remained the same. And even when I go inward within myself, I'm still that same guy that I was 40 years ago. I haven't fundamentally changed. But when I look in the mirror, obviously it tells me a different story. But the essence of me has not changed.
Well, and you know, I think that in our culture today, that concept you just said, Eric, can express itself in a negative way. And men are guilty of this too. But
women are guilty? Is that what you're saying? You said, and men are guilty of this.
We're all guilty.
Yeah, we're all guilty of this. But, you know, cosmetic surgery is a multi-billion-dollar industry. All right? And let's be honest with ourselves. You know, who has cosmetic surgery the most? Women do. You know, the facial
and
the boot job.
We really need to look at the studies on that one.
I'm willing to make a bet on that.
I see some guys with some unnatural calves.
Well, like I said, I men are guilty
abs.
With it too.
Abs.
Okay.
And butt implants.
You know, but how many people do you know that spend so much money on facelifts and, you know, boob tucks and, you know, and you know, all this other stuff? Why? Because they're a little bit older, but they want to remain young on the outside. Because they think that if they look young on the outside, then they are young.
I'm inside out, baby.
Yeah.
I'm young on the inside, and hopefully it'll radiate on the outside, man. I'm going to ride it out the way I came.
Well, I mean, I see what you're saying, Bill. I understand if somebody is, like, got nothing going on in the inside, and so they do the outside, and they try to create this facade for them. But I think sometimes, you know, for self-esteem reasons, I think some people are allowed to do what they want to do, but I do think that it has to be inside out, too. It can't just be outside in.
Yeah, because this becomes artificial.
Yeah, it has.
I mean,
well,
yeah.
It's already been artificial.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it's like at what point in time do you take the inside and say, because sometimes people that are really internally young sit there and look at themselves in the mirror and go, this isn't fair. I mean, I'm young, and I look like I'm this, you know? And I can understand if somebody feels like, I want to look younger because I feel younger.
Some some of the youngest people that I encounter are the elder sisters at church.
Right.
You know,
yeah, you talked about in the last hour.
I talked about in the last hour because they've got this essence about them that it's a free essence, you know, and I respect that. And I'm hugging them. And they seem less burdened oftentimes than some of the youth that I teach, you know, in Sunday school sometimes. So, again, it's a state of mind. It's a state of being. But I think it's a healthy posture that young at heart. And it means something. It really does. And it radiates.
And it does. Well, the other one does, too, by the
way. Yeah.
And because
there's always an opposite. Yeah.
And again, I'll go back to, you know, you're right, Ashley. If someone feels a certain way and therefore they want to look a certain way, I agree. That's cool. But I think you and I both know people who do it the opposite.
Oh, well, you got always. People out there that are doing plastic surgery to try to look like somebody famous. You got that new craze that went around for the last few months. I couldn't believe that, where they had people on the news that wanted to look like Angelina Jolie. So these plastic surgeons would map out exactly what they needed to do to make, Sandra J look
awkward.
I mean, and there was a lot of different cases, but I do agree with you. It can get out of control. But if it's because, you know, if there's certain things about you that you feel is holding you back and you're very young at heart, then I understand that. But let's talk about, there's time limits. I think people always define themselves with a time limit. Well, I got X amount of years on me, and I know that the average person only lives for this long. And so if I add a few years because I've been more healthy than the normal person, then I'll still be able to drive till I'm 75. And then after that, I won't be able to drive anymore. And then I'm going to have all these issues. But I think that by putting a time limit on ourselves, we're really actually aging ourselves faster. And I think that there's a lot of people. There's been stories lately about lots of people that have been going back to school at the ages of 85 and greater. They're going back to school. They're getting their degree. Running marathons. Yeah. And I think it's the way we look at it, because I think that we've been sold this bill of goods for a long period of time, is that, you know, you're in your teens, you're allowed to get in trouble, you're allowed to sow your oats. You know, you get in your 20s, you go through college, you graduate, you do what you got to do. You get married, you have children. You know, in your 30s, you do this, you do that. You know, you go to the country club, or you start playing tennis, or you're taking care of the kids, you're running them to and fro. And by the time you're 50, the kids are out of the house, and now you're allowed to live out your golden years. What the heck is that crap? I mean, like, I really think that it's a bill of goods that we've all been buying into, and I really think that putting a timeline on our life is asinine.
Well, and I think that's why some people do what they call a midlife crisis, and they kind of go overboard with it.
When they can do a midlife crisis anytime they want. I mean,
right,
you can be 80 years old, but I think that a lot of times we think life is over at whatever age.
Oh, yeah. You know, birthdays. I'm about to turn. I'm about to turn 40, or they turn 50, or whatever. Oh, they're just devastated. Oh my God, I'm about to turn 40. I mean, what am I gonna do now? You know, and it's like, chillax.
Exactly.
Jeez, you know, it's
until you turn 40.
You know, well, I turned 40 earlier this year, and it was no big deal to me.
I'm kidding.
I'm not scared.
Not scared.
I'm not scared. No, but seriously, I mean, think about it. And I think a lot of times when we put these age requirements on ourselves, I think it kills our inner child. I mean, all of us were born with this inner child that has fun, that likes to skip and run in the dewy meadow, you know, that likes to, have fun, that likes to have kid fun, that likes to swing on the swing set, that likes to do that kind of stuff. And well, let's talk about more of that when we return, but let's talk about that kid in you, and then let's talk about overall how you can be happy in your day-to-day life. So stay tuned, because Perspectives with your host, me, Ashley Burgess, will be back in two shakes.
I can lift you up. I can show you what you want to see and take you where you want to be.
Get in here. Give us your perspective. We're listening. And you're listening to Perspectives with Ashley Burgess.
Welcome back live to Perspectives, and I'm your host, Ashley Burgess. And on tonight's show, we have been discussing what it means to be truly happy. You know, a lot of people feel like happiness is elusive. You know, it's hiding behind some sort of corners in some sort of dark alley. I don't know where to find it. I don't know where to get it. I would trade anything for it. And I understand, because when you're not happy, you're not happy. It's just the way it is. And right before the break, we were talking about young, you know, because happy ends with a Y. And so when you're young and you're young at heart, we've been discussing that. And we just finished up discussing about not killing your inner child. I think when people define themselves by age, I am XYZ age. I am not supposed to do that. That is not what my age group does. Or I'm not allowed to do that.
Yeah, the other way. You're supposed to do this or supposed to do that.
Oh, yeah. Or this is my label. I therefore have to be that. I am a spouse. I am a parent. I am a 50-year-old parent that's not supposed to get on the playground, and I'm not supposed to swing on the swing set because that's not what 50-year-old people do. Instead, I'm going to go home and moan about why I didn't get to get on the playground and why I had to stand on the side and act like the adult.
Well, you know, I am that 40-something-year-old parent, and I got on the track with my middle daughter. She was at the studio one evening, and I went running with her. I paid the painful price in the end, but it was funny because all the other kids were looking at me like, look at your dad running with us. And it was a pause. It was a disconnect. But I had the greatest time, you know, and they thought that was the coolest thing,
you know,
because I was acting like a kid.
I can remember a couple of years ago when my niece and nephew came to visit, and we took him down to the playground. And I got up in the swing, with them, to kind of chasing them around and whatever like that. And some of the moms, they were looking at me like, wow, he's like actually playing with the kids.
But it felt good though, man.
And
then the kid looked at you like, wow, he's doing it too.
Yeah.
You know, and it's those moments that mean something.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
I love that. That's kind of cool. I mean, you didn't go as far as if the kid peed in his pants, he didn't pee your pants. But, I mean, you know, it's pretty cool.
I don't know. I'm kind of
It's cool to pee your pants. No, but I remember that. Anyway, long story.
No, you know me.
And the movies I like to watch. You know, God bless us all. But you got to love the kid in you. And I think that is so awesome because when you're being authentic and you're being in the moment and you're being in the present moment, right, that kid is allowed to come out and do what the kid wants to do. And it's not like it's crazy. I mean, it's just, you know, going back to your primal, your original, you know, self.
And maybe we should clarify on this, Ashley. Ashley's not saying be irresponsible. Okay.
No,
you know, forget all your responsibilities.
Yeah. Break all the laws.
Go break the laws or
go to the pokey.
Or if you just decide you don't want to go to work that day, well, you know, guess what? I mean, consequences will happen if you just not show up to work. Okay. So you got to, like Elvis used to say, TCOB, take care of business.
Yeah. But be in the moment, though.
But be in the moment,
have
you know?
Fun in the moment, you know?
I mean, even at work, unless you just have a complete jerk of a boss, then you can have fun at work.
Even if you do, there's probably somebody at work that you can kind of crack up with,
you know? Just be yourself.
Just have fun, you know?
Life, to put a time limit on it, but it is too short. It is too short. So have fun in it. Extend it as much as you can with joy and laughter.
I agree with that. So how old are you? And I think that is how old are you is how old you think. How old are you is how old you think and how you act. And so it doesn't really matter what your age number is, but by the way you think and by the way you act determines your age. And so I think that's critical to understand. So I think we should put it all together. Let's put it all together. Yeah, let's talk about what happy is. H-A-P-P-Y. H-A-P-P-Y.
Give me an A.
Give me an age.
No pee-pee, though.
No pee-pee. Right, at least not until you get to the bathroom.
Skip to the Y.
Not in the pool.
Yeah, not in the pool.
I like that. See, there's no pee. What is it? This is my ool. See, there's no pee. Keep it that way. Remember that sign?
No.
My friend's dad used to have this sign, and it said, this is our ool, O-O-L. You see there's no pee in it? Keep it that way. And then he was the same guy that used to have those pellets that they would put in the pool. And so when somebody would pee in the pool, it would turn green or blue or red and follow that person, you know, because
that's hilarious.
You got to follow the stream, right? But yeah, that was pretty funny.
That's hilarious.
That guy was a jokester. I love that guy. When I ever get a pool, I'm going to get those tablets too.
Oh, Lord. Note to self.
Yes, I know. Huh? Yeah, don't go swimming with
Avoid
that.
Ashley's pool.
Yeah.
And you'll never be invited again. No, I'm just kidding. I mean, no. But so let's talk about this. Talk about happy.
Bring it home.
So happy. What is happy? Happy is being honest. It's being authentic. It's being present. It's being purpose. And it's being young. So we talked about honesty earlier, and it's about being honest in your dealings, in your relationships. But I think we really grounded it to the point that it's about honest intimacy, honest with your emotions when it comes to yourself and it comes to every relationship you're having.
I agree. That has to be core. That has to be central. That has to be elemental.
Yes.
And yeah. Bill says yes. Answer is
to all of
yes.
I think, yeah, well, ditto, you know. Yeah.
And I think that intimacy is something that we all have to deal with. And I think intimacy is something that is more of a wise, more of a wisdom type thing. And it's also more of something that's more critical and more deep to deal with. But once we start dealing with the intimacy on our own and with ourselves and being able to get to our, you know, our true self, our authentic self, it's easier for us to be authentic and it's easier for us to be intimate. And I'm not talking about sex.
Right.
It's easier to be intimate. You know, you can have sex, whatever. But it's easier to be intimate with other people when you're able to be intimate with yourself.
I think it all starts with yourself. And that's not a selfish thing to say, by the way. This is a context where it's good to be selfish, because if you're not honest with yourself, if you're not authentic with yourself, and the two go hand in hand, by the way, then how can you be authentic or honest with somebody else, or be authentic or in the present in a given situation? It has to start with yourself.
Yeah, and I shared earlier, as a father, I have to with my kids, not from the fact that they'll see right through it, but I owe them that. If nothing else in this world, their father, and as parents, we have to be honest and straight with our kids. If they don't get it anywhere else in the world, they at least have to experience it, at least mine, in my household.
I like that. And being authentic. And I think that everybody can attest to this that's listening tonight, that Bill, Eric, and I are pretty authentic people.
Yes.
And I think everybody listening probably are very authentic as well. You know, the big thing is just choosing to be authentic. It's choosing to not try to mimic what we see, to not trying to be someone we're not. And I think specifically for younger listeners, I think this is really important. And I know that it can be easy to fall trap to be someone you're not. And even through just habit, you know, even older, the more habit you have of not being yourself because you don't feel like people are going to accept you, that's also an issue too. And it's sometimes you have to just back it up and say, why did I create this representative? What was I obtaining from being this representative? You know, I am. You have a name tag on there. And what did I get out of it? What was the purpose it served? Does it any longer hold that purpose for me? Or can I discard this representative and say, okay, now it's time for my true self to emerge and let's see what happens? You know,
which takes a lot of courage. It's easier said than done in some circumstances or with some people, you know, especially if you're used to living your life repressing your true self. Then it takes a lot of courage. You know, it takes courage to be, you know, someone who marches to the beat of a different drummer. You know, our culture prizes, what's the word I'm looking for?
Assimilation?
Assimilation, but also, what's the word I'm looking for?
You put me on the spot here?
Yeah, I'm putting you on the spot here.
Tell me what you're talking about.
I'm having a brain fart here, what's the word? Our culture prizes where we all do the same thing.
Oh, conformity.
Conformity. Golly.
Yeah.
Hello.
Okay.
I don't know where my brain is tonight. But anyway, conformity. And
you are conforming and not knowing.
Yeah, exactly.
No, it's true. But you mean everybody, like, kind of cookie cutter? Like do this way, this works. Don't do that way, that doesn't work.
And why do I do those things? Because that's just what everybody does, and that's the way we've always done it.
Which is fundamentally counterintuitive.
Exactly.
Which is fundamentally counterintuitive.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it seems to have worked for a lot. That's why we ban things that we don't like to deal with. That's why we write off things that we don't want to accept. So let's talk about present, being in the moment. I think when you're in the moment and you're not in the past, you're not in the future, you're not making judgment on yourself. A lot of times we make judgment on other people based on the judgments we make on ourselves. You know, and sometimes when it seems to hit home, those people seem to have some of the same characteristics that we might not like that much about ourselves. But when we make judgment calls about anybody or ourselves, we're not in the present moment. And when we finally step back and allow that moment to be, there's no longer that self-sabotaging behavior, because when you're in the moment, you can't fixate on that stuff because you take yourself back out of the moment again. You go from being an active participant to I'm now a spectator to, oh, wait, I'm back to an active participant. Wait, I'm a spectator again every time you're making judgment. Because you're looking at it from another person looking back at you. You're not yourself at that point.
Which is all confusing for me.
Right. So, yeah, me too.
So just stay in that moment, be true to that moment, be an authentic you in that moment, and it's a little bit less complicated.
I like that too, as well as purpose. You know, a purpose to have your clear direction, to realize when you connect with your purpose, you're connecting to that next dimension, you're connecting with yourself. You're actually figuring out why you're here. You have structure. You have direction. And lastly, but not least, being young and being young at heart and realizing that your age does not define you, that you define you, and realizing that there is no time limit. You have the rest of your life to deal with what you want to do to achieve this purpose. There's no cutoff at 50. There's no cutoff at 60. Every single different decade should be a very interesting celebration for you. So I think with that in mind, and by understanding that it's only as old as you act and that you can be that inner kid again, happiness should be right there. It should be. You should be able to see it and embrace it at this moment to realize how happy you truly are.
I'm loving it, Ashley. And I really appreciate the topic tonight. And I know our listeners have too. So thanks for everybody who's been posting on Facebook and Twitter. And be sure and catch this show on iTunes or Spreaker.
Power to the people.
Awesome
Power
show,
to the
Eric.
People. Power to the people.
Yep.
Awesome show, Bill.
Thanks.
And we love our listeners, and we're happy that you're listening tonight. And stay tuned, because Perspectives with your host, me, Ashley Burgess, will be back in. We'll be back in three shakes.